I'm James Taylor, and this video is a basic intro to creating joints and skinning our characters in Maya. Now, to get started, we want to do one of two things. We want to switch to our rigging shelf, or we want to change our dropdown to rigging to get access to our rigging tools. So I'll click my Create Joints tool, and I'll create it in the perspective view, but we'll see it doesn't give us good placement. When we're creating joints, we're almost certainly going to be doing it in our orthographic view, so the front or the side view. When we do that, we'll see that we get much more predictable results. So I'll start creating joints again, but we'll note that we have a different problem now. Our geometry obscures the joints. We need to click this button here, X-ray joints, and now our joints will be visible no matter what. It'll make placement a lot easier. Okay, so let's start placing joints. I'll activate my Create Joints tool, and I'll create a line of joints running up the center of the character, and this will be my spine. And what I want to do is use my snap tool, so I'll hold down V and snap that spine right to the center. And right now the bones are a little bit too large, so if we look at our attributes in the channel box, we can see that I can just adjust that radius down. That'll make things a little bit easier to work with. But if I go into my skeleton menu and I go into the options for create joints, I can also adjust the bone length radius there. And now every new joint that I create will have the radius that I've set. Okay, so let's name our joints. Our root is the pelvis, and the other joints are just spine joints, and I'll call them spine 1, 2, 3, etc. And we'll note that we're not using a literal number of spine joints. We're not trying to replicate the human skeleton. I'll talk more about that in a bit. I'll switch over to my side view, and I'll turn on X-ray joints, and now I'm going to place the joints here. When we're placing our joints, we want to place them in the center of mass. So we're not going to place these where our vertebrae would be, which is to say along the back. We're going to place them in the center of the body. And again, these are not bones. They're joints. They don't function like bones. So we need to place them correctly, which means we're putting them in the center of the character's mass. Now you'll note as you move the joints, you'll see that all the joints that are children of our parent joints move at the same time. If I want to just move a joint without adjusting any of its child joints, I can hold down the D key or I can turn on insert. This will allow me to adjust the placement of a single joint without adjusting any of the other joints in the chain. So I have 5 joints here, and that should give me good deformation. I don't need to create as many spine joints as we have vertebrae. And again, I'm not putting them along the back. I want them in the center because that's going to give us proper deformation. Now, at the end of this joint chain, I have the base of the neck here, and I'm going to move that a little bit. It sits right at the bottom of the neck, and I want to create a new joint for the head. So instead of using my Create Joint tool, I'll just duplicate that joint. And when I duplicate it, you'll see that it's still parented to the chest. So to unparent it, I hit Shift P, and then I'll place that joint right at the base of the skull where the jaw and the ear meet. And then I'll parent that to the base of the neck by selecting the head first and then shift clicking the neck and then just hitting P to parent it to that joint. Okay, so let's move on and repeat this process for the arm. I'll turn on my Create Joint tool in the front view, and I'll place the joints for the shoulder right up where the shoulder meets the body, and then I'll click to place a second joint in the wrist. I'll name these with L underbar as the beginning, so L underbar shoulder and L underbar wrist, and then I'll shift to my side view and position these joints in the side view using my Move tool. And then I'll go to the skeleton menu and click on my Insert Joint tool. And then in my front view, I'll just click drag from the shoulder down to the middle of the arm to place the elbow joint. And I'll move the elbow joint into position while holding D so that it doesn't move the wrist at the same time that I'm moving the elbow. Now I want to connect my shoulder to my torso, but I can't just parent it right to the chest. I need to create an interstitial bone. I'll use my Create Joint to create a new joint that sits just off center from the chest. This is my clavicle, and I'll parent my shoulder to the clavicle and then parent the joint to the chest. And now I've got a pretty good joint chain for my arm. Next, I'll repeat this same process with the leg. So I'll create a joint for the hip and a joint for the ankle. And that hip joint will sit in the center of the mass in the hip, and the ankle definitely sits behind the hip joint. We want to make sure that we reflect that. And then again, I'll use my Insert Joint tool to just add in the knee by clicking and dragging from the hip down. I'll take a moment to name my new joints. So again, we'll put the L underbar in front of it. So L underbar hip, L underbar knee, L underbar ankle. And then I can parent my hip to the pelvis by selecting the hip first and then shift clicking the pelvis and hitting P. Now I'm going to use a new tool, my mirror joints tool. Mirror joints is in the skeleton menu, and I want to go to the options of mirror joints. And I want to change to the YZ mirror across. And then on the bottom here, I want to search for L underbar and replace with R underbar. We activate it after we've selected a joint like the hip or the clavicle, one of the joints that sits off center from our spine, and it'll flip our joint chain across the center, creating that mirrored biped that we need. So now we've got a basic skeleton. Let's try attaching the body to it and see what happens. So I'll click my body mesh and then shift click my pelvis, and I'll go to my skin menu and choose bind skin, and I'll go to the options of bind skin. I'll change my bind method to geodesic voxel, and then I'll just hit bind skin or apply. And I just want to test things out here. So I'll grab the shoulder here, I'll turn on rotate, and I'll move it. And I'll see that I get some problems with the way things rotate. And this is to be expected the first time we bind a character's skin to the body. Now we really run into a problem when we try and mimic certain movements of the body. So I've rotated the forearm up, but we see that if I were to do that on a real body, it would break the elbow. And same thing happens with the knee. I can bend it in one direction, but if I try and bend the hip in the other direction, for example, I'm trying to cross my legs, we run into problems. So we don't have enough joints here. We need to start creating helper joints. In my skin menu, I'll select go to bind pose, and that will return my character to its default pose. And then I'll just do an edit delete by type history on the skin. That'll get rid of my skin cluster node. And now I can edit my skeleton before I reattach the skin to it. I'll start by just deleting the duplicated mirror joints because I'm going to be making significant changes to the original joints, and I can just mirror them later. So I'll go back to the skeleton menu and select my insert joint tool again, and I'm going to start adding helper bones. So the first is in the upper arm, the second is in the forearm, and you'll see that I place them at various points along the length of these bones. I also need a helper joint between the hip and the knee. And these are roll joints. So I have a forearm roll joint, a thigh roll joint, and then up near the shoulder, I have a bicep roll joint. Next up, I'll create the hand. And the hand is a difficult area simply because there are a lot of joints in a very small region. Fortunately, all the joints do basically the same thing, so we're going to create a single finger and then just reuse it to create the rest. Once again, I've used my Create Joints tool to create the finger joints, and if you hold Shift while using the Create Joints tool, you'll create them in a straight line. After that, I've just resized them, and I'm going to reposition them to roughly match the shape of one of my fingers. Now, like a lot of joints on the body, the fingers are only going to bend in a certain direction unless something goes really wrong. So I'm going to open up my joint attributes, and I'm going to find the attributes called degrees of freedom. And we'll see I've turned off the X and the Z attributes, and this means I'll only be able to rotate the joint in a single direction. Once that single finger is correct, I can then go ahead and place it for all the other fingers, just duplicating it. And I'll just reposition the joints slightly to match the geometry of the fingers, and I'll rotate them into place where necessary. Positioning the thumb is different, however. It sits off axis from the rest of the hand, about 45 degrees. That means that we'll need to rotate those joints slightly to match that. And in this case, I've positioned the joints where I want it, and I'm actually going to move the verts of the hand to match the position of the joints a little bit better. It's also worth noting that that first joint sits up in the hand, unlike the rest of the fingers. Once the fingers are set, I'll parent them to the wrist joint. So again, selecting the children and then shift clicking the parent, the wrist, and hitting P. However, with the ring and the pinky finger, I'll create another joint that sits right in the middle of the palm. I'll parent the ring and the pinky to that new joint, and then I'll parent that joint to the wrist. And this will allow me to bend the hand just a little bit better to create a more natural fist shape, for example. And once I'm done setting up the limbs, I'll just use my mirror joint to flip my skeleton over the center line. and it's time to start waiting for reels. So skin, bind skin, and I want to make sure geodesic voxel is turned on. And then I'll start to pose my character and we'll see that there are all sorts of errors. And the skin waiting process is really the process of fixing a lot of these errors and specifying how we want our character to move on the skeleton. So the first tool that I'm going to use is the hammer weights tool. I'll go to vertex mode, select some verts in an afflicted area, and then go to skin, hammer weights. And we'll see that that does a good job of fixing some errors, but if I use it in a different area, we'll see that it doesn't quite do the job. Here I'll just rotate a few of the joints on the skin. This is how we can evaluate whether or not our skin weighting is working. So I'll get that into position, and then I'll start using our primary skin weighting tool, which is our paint skin weights tool. So I'll go to the skin menu, paint skin weights, and I want to select the option box because we need to see the options for the tool. They'll pop up on the left there. Now the first thing that I'll do is I'll click use color ramp, and then I want to make sure that my paint operation is set to add. And what I'll do is I'll leave my value at 1 and I'll lower my opacity down to something like 0.3. And this will allow me to blend weights pretty smoothly. So white means that a vert is 100% weighted to the selected bone, whereas dark blue down to black means it's not weighted to the bone at all. So we use this heat ramp to judge how our verts are attached to our skeleton. So I select a bone first. I can do that from the menu on the left, or I can right-click and hold over a bone and choose Select Influence from the menu that pops up. Then when I start painting on verts, it's adding influence from the bone that I've selected onto that vert. So the vert is going to follow that bone more and more strongly the heavier the weighting I paint onto it. Now I can gain greater precision over the tool by going to vertex mode and selecting individual verts and then reactivating the paint skin weights tool. Once I do that, I can use the flood option after I've selected a bone so that I can just add whatever influence I've selected to those verts alone without affecting any other nearby verts. Now we'll see, I've only been painting weights on half of the character, so the character's weighting is asymmetrical. And this is okay because we can mirror skin weights the same way we mirror our skeleton. What I'll do is I'll select my mesh and go to skin, go to bind pose, and then I can go back to the skin menu and choose mirror skin weights, and I want to go into the options just to make sure that it's mirroring across the YZ axis. And now when I rotate my arms, I'll see that I get a symmetrically deformed model, which is what we're looking for. And then I'll just repeat this process over and over. So I'll rotate my joints to create a relatively extreme pose, and I'll look for verts that are deforming incorrectly, such as the verts at the lower torso on the front and the back here. And I'll right click and select influence on the pelvis. In this case, the verts in the lower torso are being affected by the spine too much, so I'll add influence and weight them to the pelvis so that they are not twisting as much, and that'll create a more natural shape. Basically, I'll move my model around, I'll look for errors in the skin deformation, and then I'll select joints around that deformation and add influence to the verts in that area until I get something that's correct. For example, in the ribcage area, we're going to be weighting our verts to the spine joints so that it behaves the way that the ribcage would. And here's another example with the leg region. In the leg, I'll weight the area above the hips a little bit to the leg bone, but you'll see that under the leg at the bottom of the body, I weight that almost entirely to the pelvis. And then running down the inside of the thigh, I'll add a little bit of influence from the pelvis as well. And this will give me a more natural stretch when that leg bends around. And after I get things looking correct in one pose, I'll move the leg into a different pose so I can adjust the verts. And here, I've selected the verts in front of the thigh, and I'm weighting those 100% to the thigh so that when the leg is up, we see we get some of that interpenetration between the body and the leg. And there are some areas that we just want to have the verts overlap. This mimics the way that muscles will squish up against each other, and the knee is a great example of where we need to make this happen properly. All the verts above the knee, I'll weight 100% to that roll joint in the thigh, and then everything below the knee will be weighted 100% to that knee joint. And then I have to split the difference in the middle. That will give me a nice sharp knee shape. Again, below the leg, 100% weighted to the knee. And then if I rotate my thigh to the side using that thigh roll bone, I'll adjust the weighting of the verts in that area so that I get a nice smooth taper from the hip to the knee, and that'll give me a nice natural roll when the leg is bent that way. Now we'll see I do something similar to that bicep roll joint. I smoothly gradate the skin weights from the shoulder to the elbow. What may help in some cases is to return to the unsmoothed version of my mesh, and I'll actually be able to see the accurate vert locations. And the low res mesh is what the paint skin weights tool is really operating on, so it can be helpful to switch to that low res mode by just hitting one. Now during this process, we'll inevitably run into a point where we want to make changes to the skeleton or the mesh itself. And to do that, we need to detach the skin, but retain history so that we can make edits. So I'll go to Skin, Unbind Skin, and I'll choose the options to turn Keep History on. Once the skin is detached, I can edit the skeleton or the mesh freely. So I can reposition the shoulder to give me more ideal deformation. And then I can mirror the skeleton again and bind the skin. We'll see that when we rebind it, we do have problems, but once we re-mirror skin weightings, our mesh should work as normal. However, we've got updated joint positions that will work better for animation. Unbinding my mesh also allows me the opportunity to make basic structural changes to the geometry. So I'll grab this edge ring around the elbow and I'll use my bevel edge with my segments set to 2 to split that one row around the elbow into 3 rows. I'll massage that geometry a little bit, but what I can now do is I can weight that top row 100% to the bicep roll, I can weight that bottom roll 100% to the forearm roll, and the middle row splits the difference, so I'll get a much more predictable and more natural looking deformation in that region. I'll repeat this process in the wrist so that I get those 3 rows sitting on the wrist. And I'll do the same thing for the joints of the fingers as well. So I'll just bevel and add a segment in there to give me 3 rows for each finger. And we do this now because it's easier to subdivide after the fact than it is to try and do it while we're working on anatomy. I'll add the same 3 rows on the knee. And with the knee, I want these rows to tilt down towards the front of the knee and bring them up a little bit at the back of the knee. That'll give me a little bit better deformation there. Now, once we've added all these extra verts and edges, it can be a pain in the butt to paint skin weights. So we're going to use our component editor, Windows, General Editor, Component Editor. And the component editor allows us to type in values for our skin weights. In the component editor, I'll select the smooth skin tab, and then I just need to select rows of verts in my viewport, and I can type in values for which bone I want them to be attached to in the component editor. As an example, I'll select these top 2 rows on the middle finger here, and I want to weight those 100% to the middle finger joint. So I'll select all the values for those verts, and I'll type in 1 that will weight them 100% to that joint. All the other joint influences will disappear. So repeat this for the middle finger. I'll select those rows, weight them 100% to the middle finger joint. Do the same thing for the tip. And then I can split the difference for the knuckles that are in between. And in this way, weighting the fingers, weighting the elbow, weighting the wrist, and the knee becomes very quick and easy. Once I've got those fingers set up, I'll be able to select all the joints of the hands and just add a little bit of rotation to that. That'll give a nice natural curvature to the fingers. And relaxing the hands is one of the most important parts of posing a character. It really adds a lot to the feel of a lifelike character instead of just a very stiff model. Eventually, we get to this point where the character's skin weighting is done and the joints are placed correctly, and then we can start posing the character. And I'll do that by creating keyframes on different frames of my time slider. That way, I can just switch frames to switch back and forth from a conservative pose to an aggressive pose like this. And I'll use these poses to tweak my weighting and to show off the character. Okay, that's it for the basics of skin and joints. Next, we're going to look at the Delta Mush modifier. It makes skinning easier. And then we'll look at the Human IK rig that's included in Maya. It's a great, quick way to start animating our character. Okay, that's it for the intro to joints. I'm James Taylor. Thanks for watching.